Science man, come out and play. Science man, come out and play. Science man, come out and play.
Hello, dear English thinking, speaking, hearing listener. Welcome to the podcast number 6 of me at Science Mug, written at ScienceMUG, the Twitter account / blog that talks about science and at the same time dives into the warm ocean of its own inconsistency while dwelling with the karma in Punta di Fioretto. And that does all of this in Ingmar, that is English question mark, the kind of a language that is to real English what the Martian is to plausibility and the Frappuccino to a good idea, and the Martian sipping a Frappuccino to something I never want to witness. Never. So right now, with voice of the damn human I control via wireless voodoo trick, I'm gonna tell you the tale of China's capital megacity Beijing, which stubbornly wears a powerful ring of pollution. My precious. In spite of risking like that its own demise.
Say it, Mark.
Mark Z. Jacobson, Song Woon Kyem, Alessandro Soliketa and Natasha Whitney are four scientists from Stanford, Caltech and the University of Southampton who decide to investigate Beijing, the Chinese mega capital city, and the extent of the consequences of its tumultuous urban expansion in the new millennium's first decade. So the four science pals, spearheaded by Professor Mark Jacobson, who I'm gonna refer to MJ from now on, cause you know I'm a big fan of Michael Jordan, I'm sure he does like that Stanford's brain have the same initials of his. Well, Prof. MJ and his science buddies do two things. One. They collect and analyze satellite and geolocated crowd-sourced data about the explosive urbanization of Beijing. Two, they then evaluated the effects of such an expansion via a very sophisticated state-of-the-art computer model. And what they find, dear listener, is kinda eerie. Because the Chinese city's growth has created what the researchers call a ring of impact that surrounds the city and its stranglingit with the environmental problems of all sorts. But let's start with phase one of our researchers' study, the collect and analyze data. MJ and colleagues need to build a dataset that take into consideration the changes of Beijing's urban coverage in space and time, the time being the 2000-2009 period. To do that, Professor MJ's science squad needs, over the Beijing's area, a large high-resolution coverage over a long time, and this need rule out the possibility for the researchers to count on visual satellite data. Visual satellites, in fact, usually collect high-resolution data only sporadically in time and space. They are kind of lazy on that. While they provide wide coverage data only at low resolution, that is not precise enough for a reliable study about urban and suburban environments search changes. So, Professor Jacobson starts asking himself, who I'm gonna call, while hearing in his head a catchy pop song from the 80s and seeing, always in his head, that must be a very intriguing place by the way, a little green blob bouncing around till he, the professor, not the little green bouncing blob, and the science bunch have an epiphany and find a solution to their problem. They call NASA. Oh, but, well, indeed the story is not that epic. But I think that dropping the space agency's name is a good way to get your attention back. Isn't it true, dear listener? Boops! See that Ryan Gosling's apps? See that NASA? See that... Anyway, dear listener, here's the real story. Prof. MJ's team decides to use NASA's QuickSat satellite's sea winds scatterometer data. Then, to make sense of these data, the team processes them with the Dense Sampling Method, aka DSM, an innovative method that can estimate urban extent and monitor urban changes over time. Finally, done all of this, the researchers can eventually map Beijing's urban and intra-urban area with a resolution of about 1 km. Whoa. My hyper jiggy me. Wait a minute. Slow down a bit and restate the last sentences of yours, please, in simple words. With calm, no rush. Make it clear. Okay. My so-called normal me. Okay. So, there was this NASA's space probe, the QuickSat. QuickSat was a satellite orbiting Earth at about 800 kilometers of height. Launched in 1999 and died, as NASA says, of an age-related mechanical failure in 2009. Rest in peace. QuickSat mission was to check the whole globe and measure near-surface wind speed and direction under all weather and clouds conditions over Earth's oceans. So NASA's satellite QuickSat, to do its job, mounted an instrument called SeaWinds. This SeaWinds instrument was a scatterometer, that is a microwave radar. Hence, it measured its own backscatter, that is the reflection of signals back to the direction from which they come, meaning the radar itself, which, in the case of SeaWinds, as you already know, was in orbit. So, Jacobson's group chose to use the data collected between 2000 and 2009 by QuickSat satellite and its scatterometer. Cause when this flying radar was beaming lands and cities, its backscatters depended on the size and on the number of the buildings on the ground and even on the materials within the buildings themselves. And no, to answer your question, dear so-called normal me, a scatterometer, even a flying NASA one, is not able to discriminate also the actual content of a hot dog in Brooklyn. Anyway, we are done with the satellite and radar stuff now. Now let's go to the dense sampling method, aka DSM, which Prof. MJ and colleagues use to make sense of this satellite and radar data. DMS is math stuff, so I'm not even trying to explain it, because to explain it, well, I should get it first, and there's no way I get it. I'm a damn blog after all, what do you want from me? I'll tell you only this, the dense sampling method works, big revelation here, on the backscattered data from the radar. Yeah, okay, I've told you that already just a few seconds ago. But repetita juvent, and above all, what you don't know yet is that DMS provides two outputs. A mean value of the various measurements done by the just hypermentioned satellites, rather, and an index of variability, called IV, of such measurements. The mean value is the average value over an annual period of measurements, while the IV represents the variations around that mean. Okay? Okay!
But the mean value by itself is not enough to identify uniquely urban areas. Why? Well, listen to this. Urban areas have higher mean values than those of the rural areas, because, well, cities have more buildings than countryside, right? But sometimes nature is tricky, and natural landscapes may also have a high mean value. For instance, a field covered by a fat slice of snow can trick the poor backscatters and the radar and be mistaken for a big roof or else instead. So a high mean value is not always an index of actual urbanization. And here is where the index of variability comes in handy. IV, and I quote from the paper, is also typically high in urban environment due to the large backscatter variability associated with human-made targets like different sizes of buildings, orientation of building corners, and vehicle traffic. So, dear normal me and listener, boops, Ryan Gosling zaps, NASA! So, by combining the mean values of the indexes of variability of our good DMS, the dense sampling method can efficiently help to provide a map of the urban extent and typology of a city. Therefore, my dear listener, the DSM is math, and it works, and it runs on data collected between 2000 and 2009 by a NASA's satellite radar,
does to summarize, a dead NASA's satellite's radar provide Prof. MJ and his mates with the kind of high-resolution plus wide coverage dataset they need for their study on Beijing, and the dense sampling method allows them to use this data to delineate and map over time and with a resolution of about 1 kilometer the urban extent of the China's capital as well as its interurban and intra-urban changes. Or, in simpler words, our fine researchers can figure out and precisely discriminate the changing presence over 10 years in the Beijing area of physical infrastructures such as houses, factories, shopping centers, skyscrapers, and so on. So, what do our nice and clever researchers find out after using space probes, microwaves, radars, and maps up? The answer after the break.
You just listened to a sample of The Sound of Silence. Download it for only 199.99 euros at iGoldenEardrum. The Sound of Silence, for who's tired of the noisy cities, or to hear.
Okay, dear listener. Now let's see what Professor Jacobson and his colleagues find out thanks to QuickSCAT's data and SMS math. The scientists established that the actual urban extent within the Beijing municipality increases of the 400% between 2000 and 2009, passing from roughly 1100 to roughly 4100 square kilometers. The remaining 12,000 and something square kilometers of the official administrative Beijing municipality are non-urban stuff, like rural areas, natural reserves and mountains with just a bunch of people living on them. So now our researchers have numbers about the roofs extent and about the vegetated coverage of the China's capital city area, but to be able to end the collect and analyze data phase 1 of their work and pass to phase 2, that is the put the data into the holy state-of-the-art computer model and wait for a muffin and an answer different from a predictable 42 about the consequences on Beijing of those above mentioned numbers, well, to pass to phase 2 of their study, our fellas scientists needed first to gather another piece of information about the urbanization of Beijing. The researchers indeed also need to know the total road surface area of the Beijing's municipality. To get that, Professor Jacobson and colleagues go use OpenStreetMap, aka OSM, Road Data. OSM is a project started in 2004 and supported by the OpenStreetMap Foundation, a UK registered not-for-profit organization. The goal of OpenStreetMap is to create, and I quote again from the paper, a free open access database of worldwide geographic information entirely contributed on a voluntary basis. Moreover, and I keep quoting from the paper, OSM road data are obtained primarily from GPS-enabled portable devices, satellite images, and commercial and governmental datasets, and the data are contributed only by registered members who do that freely, and the data are not reviewed before being made public on the internet. The good quality and general reliability of OpenStreetMap road data have been verified by different independent studies that focused on Europe, US, and China. One of these studies, in particular, is published in 2014 and assesses the completeness of OSM road data about Beijing and establishes for them data a rate of accuracy superior to the 70%, so pretty good. So, Prof. MJ and the others got the Beijing's OpenStreetMap road dataset of September 2013 and they then overlaid it to the Beijing QuickSCAT urban extents data of 2000 and 2009. Like that, the researchers can calculate and check the expansion of the total surface covered in the Chinese megacity by 29 different types of roads, regular roads, motorways, bus guideways, cycleways, crossings, etc., in 2000 and 2009 respectively. Just Carcassonne and his group Determinants does that in 2009 almost 7% of Beijing city's area is covered in roads, the main ones emanating radially from the city center.
Ah, dear listener, they did it! They finally did it! Our determined scientists have now numbers about rooftops, roads, vegetated areas and therefore also of bare soil surfaces, that is the total surface minus the other ones, of Beijing from 2000 and 2009, and they thus can pass to phase 2. They can finally get to put all these amazing shining brand new numbers into their magnificent hyper-cool sophisticated self-medicating state-of-the-art and probably even grandiously bewhiskered computer model. The god